So I just told you the partition function diverges at some value. So partition function diverging is an example of an infinity. And we just showed that it's related to a pole of the zeta function.
Right. But I actually have the same question. I want to follow up on that. But that seems like a, it's not really realized, right?
It is realized. You know, the thing is, it's realized in the same sense that phase transitions are realized. So a phase transition is a very mysterious thing, okay? Because it appears that abruptly a system changes property from magnetic to non-magnetic or liquid to solid through a phase transition. Now, one particle cannot have a phase transition. 100 particles cannot have a phase transition. But 6 times 10 to the 23 particles can have a phase transition. But 6 times 10 to the 23 is equal essentially to infinity for all practical purposes. That's what we call the thermodynamic limit. So, formally, when we study such systems, if any system which we claim is continuous, it's not continuous. So, what system? Nothing is ever continuous. In the continuous limit, this is this thing becomes singular. But since it's not continuous, this thing is very, very close to singular. So we get used to, this is not the only example. There are many infinities in physics like this. Every time there's a phase transition, something diverges. Specific heat diverges, its derivative diverges, somebody diverges. It can happen. So we shouldn't take it too literally because the number of particles, it's a limit.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, you know, I challenge you to distinguish 10 to the 23 from infinity in any way that a human being can understand.
Just a comment on the non-trivial zeros of the Riemann zeta function. Actually, it's known that the spacing between the non-trivial zeros actually coincides with the random matrix itself for Gaussian unitarians,
right.
And from Bohiga's conjecture, we know that that corresponds to classically to a chaotic system.
Mm-hmm.
So there's been a lot of effort on finding a Hamiltonian chaotic system,
mm-hmm,
whose energies would simply be the non-trivial zeros. Till now, it hasn't succeeded, but it has,
yeah,
I think, given rise to lots of number theory results from what I know from
interesting. Maybe we should give a talk on this sometime. Because you know, I attended a summer school in Lesotho in 2004, where Bohigas was actually present, and Keating also.
Keating is one of the
people who's doing this stuff, and gave a whole course on this Riemann zeta. It's very, very interesting.
Thanks for a very beautiful talk. Quantum field is not my field, but I would like to ask one question, that in this series which we are getting, does it give any information about the interaction, type of interactions? Suppose we are going from n upon to n minus 1 to n upon to n plus 1 series. So in that case, what it is revealing about the interactions?
Thank you. That's a good question. So actually, those fractional quantum Hall effect series are understood in terms of some composite objects. So this is basically Janendra Jain's proposal of composite fermions. So the idea is that you have a system of particles. Each one of them, you know what are the energy levels, but you don't know the energy levels of the whole system because they are strongly interacting. So you have to make some assumption about what these particles do. So he makes some assumption that they bind to each other due to some interaction, and then the bound object is non-interacting. Okay, so by different ways of binding these particles gives you different composite objects, and those composite objects reproduce these different series. So actually the fractional quantum Hall effect probes very sensitively the interaction among the electrons in your system, while the integer one works for basically not interacting electrons. So interactions are very important.
One distinct feature of going from integral to fractional, that in that case it was falling down to zero.
No, that's always true. In both cases that happens. It's not distinct. I'll show you. So here's the integral one first. This is the integral one.
Yeah.
So here also, you see that these are two different graphs. Huh? This one is a step function like this.
Yeah.
And this other one is jumping like this.
Okay.
So this one is the Hall conductance. And this is the resistance. This is the ordinary resistance. It's the ordinary resistance which, as you see, this wiggly line here is zero. So it's zero, then it jumps up, then it goes back to zero, jumps up, goes back to zero. So this is already happening in the integer quantum Hall effect. And the same phenomenon happens in the fractional one. The main difference is that in the fractional one, our eyes can more readily spot these zeros. You know, some of them are not real zeros. They come only up to here.
In that, all are not going to zero.
Oh, that's a, you know, these are experimental issues. Yes, this is not going to zero, but you should think of it as zero. This is basically, these are all down to experimental uncertainties, errors and inadequacy of the system, because the system has to have very low, it has to be highly pure, it has to be at very low temperature, but we can only approximate those things.
Okay.
So that is the reason these are not going down to zero. But in some fundamental sense, you should think of any dip as zero, because look, this quantity is jumping from a value so high, like 2, down to some very tiny value in a very, very small range of magnetic field. So it's as good as jumping down to zero.
Our speaker is very big.